as you said, you retired in 2013. That must have been a gut-wrenching feeling, even though probably you knew in your head the time was right, but still, when you dedicate your whole life to something like professional rugby or professional anything, I'd imagine it's very hard to walk away from it.
Yeah, absolutely. And Damien, that particular year was the first year of Rob Penny. And I that summer, I suppose, of 2012, I trained really, really hard because I knew I had to work that bit harder to try and keep the younger guys off. And I had a really, really strong pre-season. I felt really, really good. And Rob arrived in and kind of arrived in late after pre-season. I think we went to France for pre-season matches. It wasn't even considered for, for a start. I remember not getting a start in any of the warm-up games. I was really, really frustrated and angry because, you know, here's a guy coming in who, you know, I felt he had a preconceived idea already. You know, he was looking at my date of birth maybe and was looking for a clean out or whatever. But the fact that I didn't get an opportunity to show myself early on, I knew the writing was on the wall. And so that was really, really difficult, I think. And I do remember Rob kind of saying to me, look, we must meet for a coffee and have a chat, you know. And he kept doing that. He kept saying, I'll meet you for a coffee. And I remember when I started in this job after retiring, Rob was still coach there. And he goes, we must meet for that coffee. And I was like, I'm retired now. It's a bit late, you know. So
Don't worry about it.
Yeah. He was focused on something else. So that was my time.
Of course, yeah. And I suppose with new managers coming in and out, I suppose players coming in and out too like that. But I suppose coaching, was that something that was always on your mind after retirement? I know it's a subject now that you don't like talking about, but we're going to talk about it.
No, you're right. Look, I would have loved to have continued coaching. I think while I'd say timing was great for me as a player, timing was really, really poor for me as coach. My goal as I left by instead of the underage stuff within Shannon, and I had taken a year away, and UL Bowes, which is close to where I live, asked me to help out. Colin Tucker was coaching there, and he just asked me to come along and help. And
Barry Murphy was involved with that, was he?
He was, exactly.
Of course, Barry. People that don't know Barry rugby-wise, they'll know him from Hermitage Green.
Exactly, yeah. But they asked me just to help out. I wasn't fully committed to them. I wasn't on the coaching staff. I was doing a bit on the scrum and stuff for them. And I really enjoyed it. You know, there was no pressure. But there was obviously uproar in Shannon the day that Bowes played Shannon and I was on the sideline.
You were the wrong side of the pitch.
So Shannon then thought, oh, Marcus has fallen out with the club and they were looking for me to come back. And I said, look, lads, there's no issue. I'm cutting my teeth in coaching and I'm doing it in a place where there's, you know, very little expectation or pressure on me. And I'm just helping them out. So as it went out, then I came back to Shannon the following year and I was looking to coach their under 20 team. Unfortunately, the way things were, we had no under 20 team. And I kind of fell in then with the second team. And then there was management changes with Shannon that year and weren't going so well and they were looking to get rid of the coach there. And then they asked me to come in as the coach, which I didn't really want to do.
It's every player's dream, Marcus, I suppose, to go back to their home club, back to their roots and take on the senior manager's role. I mean, it's a massive undertaking. And I guess maybe it wasn't the right time for you at the time, timing-wise, to take on that role. I know when I was doing my research on you, you did have a lot of bad luck with different matches and stuff, and you were short of players, missing players and stuff, and you got a heavy defeat by Glaswegians one night, and I think that was kind of the nail in the coffin for you.
Yeah, look, we would never be ones to make excuses, but when you're at that level and you're missing your top player to try and get a result. But my plan was to try and work with a Shannon under 20s team for maybe 2-3 years and try and develop a core group of players that would rank together and strengthen that senior team. And it didn't work that, but when I asked for, when I've been asked to do a job with my club, you know, I felt obligated, I suppose, in some ways to not refuse it. You know, it felt like the club were in the lurch a little bit. But unfortunately then results, as you said, didn't go my way. And I think around Christmas time, we parted ways with Shannon. And but like, I'm delighted to see them doing so well. And unfortunately, the coronavirus hit when it did. Shannon were probably on back for maybe automatic promotion. They were definitely in the playoff places. But I'm just proud to see some of the guys that I had coached, along with other coaches along the way, to see them score. But for me, coaching is probably too far away for me to get back. I love doing the consultancy work. I think I'm a bit off for that space. But, you know, paying myself full weekends, couple of days a week, to that, and it's a lot. The job is a lot more than what you just see, what people see. There's so much behind it. Coach at club level, you're everything bar the bus driver, and I think that's kind of tough, and it's a huge demand on someone who's got other things in the fire, whether it's family, job, whatever it might be. So I've huge areas that are doing it, and again, believe, I think they don't get enough credit for what they do. And I think there's some fantastic Irish coaches out there at that level that deserve a chance maybe at our level of coach, and I'd love to see that happening with some.
Brilliant. Getting away from the rugby side of things just for a minute, I want to talk about your charity work that you do. I know from my own experience, you've helped us out with the John McDonald cycle there for many years, but you're involved in other charity exercises as well.
Yeah, I am. Look, it's funny that we're talking about that. Like, I watched Paul O'Connell on the late the other night, and he talked about profile and what you can do with profile, and I absolutely agree with him in the sense that there's a certain level of embarrassment around people saying, oh, you did mighty work with this charity. I mean, some of the stuff that I've done is turning up things, and I see the work that you've done and the money you've raised and the lives you've changed with what you've done. It just, it embarrasses me when you say I'm involved with charities, right? Because, you know, it's just incredible. You know, when people roll up their sleeves or get their hands dirty and do stuff, that's another area that we try and encourage our players to do, is not just to turn up for a photo shoot, but actually to help out. But the thing is, and the reality of life and society is that what charities want is their profile raised. And if a rugby player or a famous rugby player can do that, it's a very, very powerful thing. And I suppose it has to have the merit. People have to show it the merit that it does, and what it affects. But having said that, I am involved with the Learning Hub in Limerick, in Killeely. I'm vice chairman of the board. I've been on the board now for a good number of years. It's an incredible place. Like Killeely, if anyone doesn't know it, it's not that far from Thomond Park, but it's probably attached to not just the most underprivileged place in Limerick, but probably the most underprivileged place in the country. And it frustrates me to see, I suppose, the level of effort that goes into from the individuals on the ground there and the lack of support from the governments and trying to get grants and improve conditions there as best they can, and that's really, really tough. But what I love about the place is the spirit and the drive within the people that are there. Some incredible people, incredible things out of there. We've, you know, one of our top boxers there, Hayley Kiley, she's a kickboxing champion, and the kickboxing club within the hub is just it's just incredible what they're doing with young people there, and the level of discipline these people are learning, and sportsmanship. It's just fantastic. So to be part of that is just great, and be able to facilitate that in some way is just fantastic. But the Learning Hub has so many other things. It has a music hub, it has a science hub, a digi hub. It's just amazing what they do, and we're just there to try and support them as best we can, and try and make giving people who don't really have that chance to achieve something special, you know, and whether that's academically or whether it's sportingly or whether it's musically or whatever it might be, there's a huge amount there, and we're just hopefully giving people opportunity, you know. But on top of that, then we're like, the ambassador role I had with G is one of the most enjoyable things I've ever done, to be honest. And again, as I said, embarrassing for me in some ways, because it was a lot of just turning up, pressing the flesh, taking photographs. But what a community out there in Kilcornan, and what a story. I just every time I meet someone who's interested in exploration, I always bring up Ger's name. A guy that I probably so gutted that I never got to meet. I would love to have been in his company for 5 minutes, because just an incredible man, incredible family man, incredible adventurer, a very proud Irish man by the sounds of it. His story is just so cool, and I'm very, very proud to be part of it. One of the things that I especially was last year, I climbed Kilimanjaro and I brought one of your medals up with me. I was just trying to rack my brains, what could I bring up? It wasn't going to be too heavy to bring up to the mountain, but I had that medal around my neck. It was nice to get a photo with it at the top. So, just, you know, that's just something that, you know, even though I never met the man, I feel that there is some little bit of a connection there that, you know, I've done Kilimanjaro and obviously his love of climbing and stuff like that. But just so people know as well, Demo, like the charity was raising money for something different every year. And that's what I loved about it. It touched the lives of so many different people, whether it was an individual local TE or it was a charity group local TE. It was always something for the community. And absolutely proud to be part of it.
No, it was brilliant. It was great.
And it's all over.
And I'm smiling at you, Marcus, because you just said there about what Paul O'Connell said about famous players lifting profiles and stuff. Barry, a mutual friend of ours, Barry, he always said, we always look for a famous player, but we had to get Marcus instead.
I knew I was going to get a hammer back with that one. I wasn't talking about myself.
I disagree with him totally, Marcus. I disagree with him.
You're a legend. I wouldn't expect anything else from Barry.
Before we finish up, I suppose it'd be wrong not to talk about, I suppose, that morning at the airport in Lanzarote in October 2016, when you turned on your phone and it nearly exploded in your hand. The death of Anthony was, I know he was like a big brother to you and of course, great friend to Kate and your family and all of you. But I mean, I think that whole weekend, it affected everyone across the world in rugby.
Yeah, it did. It did. And Demo, I think, you know, when you talk about all the stuff we talked about earlier and, you know, great days and things that we've won, it impales into insignificance when you think about it and think about what rugby is. It's just a game. Incredible shock today. I heard that. And do you know my one memory of that airport scene was like myself, Kate was over trying to get to figure out where our car was and get there. To get to the hotel, and my phone rang again. It was John Hayes, and I remember John just said to me, he's gone. Like, because I was, he must have sensed that I was in a bit of disbelief because of where I was, and it was so surreal. But he was just so blunt, that's kind of when I knew that, you know, that was it, like, you know. So, that's my one strong memory of that day, and then obviously. you're just thinking, we got to get home. You know, we were leaving an airport to go to a hotel for a week and a week and a bit.
For a well-deserved holiday.
Yeah, but we were thinking is, look, we need to get home. We need to get home. So we got home that Wednesday. But yeah, it's just it kind of hammers home that you kind of need, and Axel would never have been a guy that would have, I suppose, said a huge amount. But it's one thing I've said afterwards, you kind of feel that you probably should have said a lot more to him while you had the chance, you know what I mean? And I think for us as a group of lads that kind of played together, we're kind of doing that a little bit better now. We're connecting a bit more, whether it's just the WhatsApp group or trying to meet a little bit more.
I can imagine, Marcus, the relationship that you and Axel had. Like, if you turned around and said something soft to him, he'd probably dig you in the head, like, you know. But I mean, it was funny. Yeah. I suppose it wasn't funny, like, but he was a few years older than you. But both he followed the same path. Both he Clareman, both he went to Munchen's, both he went to Shannon, then Munster, then Ireland. It was incredible that the path both he took. And I know you once described him as being like a big brother to you.
Yeah, and he would have been. He would have been my rugby big brother, I suppose, in the sense that exactly that. He paved the path for not just me, but for a lot of other guys, to be honest with you. But he was just a rock of sense as well. You know, I would have been kind of regarded as a guy who lost the head a lot on the pitch, maybe off the pitch as well. But he would have been a calming influence on me in so many ways, as was his dad, Brendan. I remember getting lifts with them to matches and to training. And Brendan would always kind of, maybe it came from Axel to say, look, Dad, will you say something to him in the car? Because I remember Brendan saying things to me and probably even taking the pitch that day in the match, I would probably have that in my head to stay a bit calm. Now, it would probably work for 10 minutes and then I'd lose the cool anyway. But, you know, it was just trying to maybe get me to calm down a small bit. But they're the things that Axel probably put that time into other people that he felt was worth doing it for. And he was a good man to look at someone who, or to spot someone who he felt going to do good things or be a good player. And he brought that into his coaching.
He was an incredible man, and he was loved by all around the world, I suppose, really. And you could see that from the weeks after his funeral and stuff. But I suppose my question, Marcus, you've been on the sideline as a manager for Shannon. You know the stress the managers are under. Do you think there's more influence, we'll say, on players' health on the sideline or on the pitch than there is? Should there be more put on management? Because they're under a lot of stress.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a great call, Damon. Yeah. I think, and look, the role that I'm in at the moment, we're all focused on the players and the staff and the backroom staff there is huge. And I suppose when we do have some past players going into that space, we do cater for them. But I suppose there's a lot of coaches out there that haven't come through our system. But that mental health, that checking in on people, I think, is, to be honest with you, it's not, I wouldn't just say about sport. It's about anything in life. And I think when you talk about how we've all sort of slowed down our pace of life now over this coronavirus thing, there's a lot of people working there in high pressure jobs. And I'm even thinking of all the people now who are on the front line and how tough that is. And please God, they will get the time to switch off and step away from it. But that is so important. Be able to not carry the burdens of your job with you home, and not to be worrying about it 24/7 is vital for your health and for your well-being. And I would apply that to anything you're doing. You know, even something that you enjoy, it can frustrate you at some stage. I know there's a lot of golfers out there that have thrown golf clubs into ditches. So, no, you do. You need to step away from stuff. And I think you know, the coaches are definitely in that bracket. And I think there's so much more scrutiny around their performances and how quickly people can turn on them. So from being a hero as a coach, winning a trophy, the beginning of the following season, you can see it even in the Premiership soccer. Guys are sacked and a new guy is put in there straight away. So it's it's a tough life, and I think we have to consider.
No, it is. I agree with you. I suppose, Marcus, before I finish up, I just want to ask you the last three things I want to ask you is, you've played with and against some of the best players in the world. Who's your best player in your head that you've ever played with or against?
I would select a few people in different ways, right? Like for me, Axel was the ultimate guy to play with, because for me, he just he carried what I believe Shannon kind of instilled in everybody, was to protect the young players coming up along, which was done for me. And probably
he covered your ass a lot.
Yeah. But I do remember one incident where I was playing in an AIL game in Thomond Park, and I stood at the edge of the ruck waiting for, I don't know, was it Victor Costello or Trevor Brennan or whoever it was, who were about to take a ball to run at us. And Axel saw me and pushed me out of the way to take the tackle, because one, I don't know, did he trust me to do it or he was protecting me? But second of all, I think it was probably, if it was Victor, it was probably to put one over on Victor, because they were battling for the same place in the Irish team. But that was the kind of guy he was.
Right, that's the kind of guy he was. We'll go with the latter. He was trying to protect you.
Yeah, exactly. But I suppose ultimately, I'll just say on a world stage, I think, and it's kind of hard for me because he's a Leinster man, but like one of the toughest guys I felt, and I think Brian O'Driscoll for us, for a country that we have, we produce one of the best rugby players in the world, and to have played alongside him, played against him, yeah, he's right up there. And I think we sometimes love to hate our own, especially provincially, but yeah, credit where credit's due, he's been incredible.
100% I agree with you. Yeah. Who would be your best coach that you've ever coached? Has ever coached you?
Yeah, well, if you asked me that question when I was still playing, right, you wouldn't get the same answer. But my two coaches that I had, I suppose, with Munster were Declan Kidney and Niall O'Donovan. And I suppose maybe while I was playing, I would never have ever put, you know, Decky up there, because we would have clashed a lot. Mm. But I think after you've coached a little bit yourself, you kind of get what he was trying to do.
And you understand the dynamics.
Decky would have been not just about you as a player. He was about you as a person. And I think that's really, really important in whatever walk of life you're in, is that if someone's there to do a job for you, it's not just the job alone. You've got to check in about the other stuff. And we would have laughed and joked about Decky asking you, how are you and how are things at home and stuff like that. But that's hugely important. And Niall, for me, was old school. He kind of they balanced each other really, really well, because Niall wasn't into that soft kind of how are you kind of thing. So there was a good balance between the two of them, and I think they nailed it together.
But it's funny you mentioned Deco there a minute ago, because I was listening to an interview with Stephen Gerrard the other night, and he was asked a similar question, and he said like that. Gerard Houllier, when he was younger, he'd be ringing Stephen Gerrard's mother and father to see how Gerrard's getting on and what's he eating for his dinner, and he'd call over to meet his mum and dad for tea, like this kind of stuff. Whereas when Benitez came on in, like Gerrard nearly left Liverpool, like, because it was a different management skill completely. Yeah. Do you know, and that's the way it is.
Yeah.
But lastly then, Marcus, I guess the funniest moment in your rugby career that you can think of. I'm sure you've got a bag of moments.
Yeah, there's been some classics. I mean, there was one that I haven't been involved. I wasn't there on the day because I was out injured. But like, and I only saw it recently. Was Dunica losing his shorts? I suppose, you know, we still get great kick out of that because he's so embarrassed by it. But a man that loves the messing, that was genuinely. Not people think like he loves that kind of thing. That absolutely gets to him, and I think it's hilarious. But one of the good ones I have was, again, it was Dunica's first cap with Ireland. I think he came off the bench the same day, but we played in the Millennium Stadium, and I remember getting the bus up the main street, and you turn right down into the stadium, and there was a couple, an Irish couple, walking towards us, and we all had our headphones on. But as she looked up, she kind of noticed, oh, there's the Irish bus, and you could see her mouthing, oh, there's the Irish team, and she starts waving, but kept walking. And the boyfriend saw us as well, and was like, she was waving and looking at the bus and walked straight into a post, and, like, smacked her nose off the post. And I let out a roar of laughter, and everyone just stopped, and like, it was, we were pure serious on the bus trying to be focused on the game, and everyone was out pointing at her. And the boyfriend turns around and points at her as well and starts laughing. So he got a great kick out of it too. So really, really lightened the mood put into the stadium, you know. But that sticks out in my head, because even in the dressing room afterwards, when the game was over, everyone was like, remember your one before the game when you walked into the post? So everyone remembered it, you know.
But you know what? It's been brilliant, Marcus, talking to you and going back over your career. You've had some fantastic memories, good and great memories and sad memories, but memories are the same, you know. And I think that's what makes life, and it makes everything worthwhile. And I really appreciate you taking the time out to talk to me. And keep up the good work you're doing with Player Ireland. And I suppose for yourself, Kate, and the lads, just stay safe out there in these times.
You too, Demo. Listen, we'll hopefully do this over a pint at some stage when this all clears up, all right?
All right, listen, mind yourself. Thank you very much.
Good man.
See you, Marcus.